Indeed, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. For the Lord has given us another day to worship our God in spirit and in truth. And we are so delighted that you have joined in to worship with us this morning. If you worshiping us through Facebook, we ask you right now to go ahead and have a watch party on your page so that others who are your friends and not our friends will be able to worship God with us. And for those of you who are watching us on YouTube, call a friend and let a friend know to sign in to Charlie Stallworth TV that we may be able to worship God together as we celebrate and worship out of our own historical presence. As we say to the saints, come over here where the table is spread and the feast of the Lord is going on. Come on, core group, act like you want to have some church this morning. Invitation. Come over.
Come over here.
Table is spread.
Table is spread.
Feast of the Lord.
Feast of the Lord.
It's going on.
It's going on.
Come on, drink.
Drink from the fountain.
And never.
And never must dry.
Come on, eat.
Eat from the table of the bountiful supply.
Come on, come.
Come over here.
Table is spread.
Table is spread.
Feast of the Lord.
Feast of the Lord.
It's going on.
It's going on.
Come on, drink
from the fountain
and
never runs dry.
Come on, eat
from the table of the bountiful supply.
Wherever you are, put those hands together. Come over here.
Come over here.
Table is spread.
Table is spread.
Feast of the Lord.
Feast of the Lord.
Is going on.
It's going on.
Come on, drink
from the fountain.
Come on, drink
from the fountain.
Come on,
drink from the fountain.
Come on and
drink from the fountain.
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 Ever flowing fountain.
Drink from the fountain.
Ever flowing fountain.
Drink from the fountain.
Drink.
Eat from the table of the bountiful supply.
Eternal God, we thank you, we love you, we bless you now. We find our way and we celebrate our way into your presence. Abide with us and do what only you can do in this worship service. God, we love you and we thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Oh!
Come over here. Table is spread. Feast of the Lord. Going on, drink from the fountain that never runs dry. Eat from the table of the bountiful supply. Come over here, table is spread. Feast of the Lord is going on. Drink from the fountain that never runs dry. Eat from the table of the bountiful supply.
Let it rise.
Let it rise.
of the Lord. Rise among us, let the praise of our King. Rise among us, let it rise.
We say, oh,
the Reverend Dr. C.L. Stallworth and the Andrew Ministry here at the Tabernacle, we greet you in the name of Jesus. We are blessed that you have decided to join us and fellowship with us through our online worship service. May blessings continue to overflow in your lives. Please join us as we are led in our vision statement from the pulpit.
Amen. We thank God for Tiffany being back. I know she's been out a couple of weeks. And Nadine, I told them this morning I'm going to have to take them in the church and rebaptize them all over again. But thank God as they are part of this ministry, being a blessing to this ministry. We ask you to share with us our vision statement as it is on your screen. You will be able to share with us because we believe this is what God continues to do in this place. Let us share together. Our vision is to use innovative tools of evangelism to reach a diverse community generationally, racially, and culturally. In the East End and Greater Bridgeport vicinity for God as revealed in Jesus Christ. Utilizing biblical teachings, dynamic worship, spiritual gifts, and natural talent development in a judgment-free zone. And to enhance and produce mature saints in the spirit of excellence for the work of ministry. Amen. You know you're in East End when you hear us say, the Lord is blessing me right now, and right now. Woke me up this morning and started me on my way. Come on, come on. The Lord.
The Lord is blessing me. Yeah.
Put your hands together if you know the Lord is blessing you right now.
Kill me, only make me strong. I have to know. I have to know.
I have to know.
Have to know is in his plans. What a great word to enter into this time of prayer, because indeed God knows the plans that God has for us to prosper us and to give us a future. As we go to God in prayer this morning, there are so many things we pray about, and we remember our city. I was informed this morning of two more deaths of young people to gunfire. Pray for those families, and we pray for our city, we pray for our world, and pray for those people whose hand you would normally hold while standing here at the altar.
Oh, yes.
Many of you remember who you used to stand next to. Remember those persons in prayer today as Minister Harris will come to lead us.
Father God, we come before your throne of grace on this morning. Father God, we come recognizing and realizing that you are God and you're God all alone. No one above you, no one beside you, Lord God. You are righteous in all your glory, God. And on this morning, Lord God, we give you the praise, we give you glory, we give you honor, we extol you, we exalt you, God. Hallelujah, because of who you are. Father God, we come before your throne of grace with a thanksgiving in our hearts and a praise on our lips. Lord God, you brought us through. You took us over, oh God. You made a way, Lord God. You kept us. You held us, Lord God. And for that, Lord God, we praise you and we give you the glory and the honor. Father God, we ask, oh God, for forgiveness of our sins on this morning, Lord God. We know that when we sin, we don't sin against ourselves, Lord God, but we sin against you, God. Hallelujah, God. And it's not our intentions, oh God. We intend to do right, God. But when you tell us to go right, sometimes we go left, God. But we thank you, Lord God, that you are a forgiving God. Hallelujah. So we thank you, Lord God, for forgiveness on this morning. Hallelujah, God. We lift up our pastor, the Reverend Dr. C.L. Stallworth. Lord God, we plead the blood of Jesus over his mind, his body, and his soul. We ask, oh God, that you would continue to walk with him, Holy Ghost. That you would continue to rest on him, Lord God. In his weakness, oh God, step in as being strength, Lord God. In the rough times, oh God, be that calm, oh God, in the midst of the storms, Lord God. God, we ask that you bless him, oh God. They've already done it, Lord God, but we're asking, oh God, that you would continue to bless him over and over and over again, Lord God. We pray, oh God, that you would place people in his paths, oh God, that would help him, oh God, that would strengthen him, oh God, as he walks to his destiny that you planned, oh God. Hallelujah. We bless you for him, oh God, and we thank you for him, God. God, we lift up those that are sick on this morning.
Yes, Lord.
Father God, you know the names that we've been praying for, oh God. We lift them up to you again on this morning. Lord God, we lift up those that are bereaving, those that have lost loved ones, oh God. Those that are in broken relationships, oh God. Those that are broken, oh God, mentally, oh God, and emotionally, Lord God. We lay them at your feet on this morning, oh God, because we know that you're a doctor that has never lost a case. So we ask, oh God, that right now you would write a prescription for healing, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Father God, we lift up those that are in the homes, Lord God, that are with us right now watching, Father God. I don't know what they stand in their need of, oh God, but you do, Lord God. So we ask, oh God, that you would meet the need, oh God, that you would fix it, oh God, that you would pick them up and carry them through, Lord God, like only you can, God. Oh, hallelujah. We give you the glory, the praise, and the honor. Father God, we lift up this world on today, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you would move like never before, Lord God, because we need to feel a move from you, oh God. We need to see, hallelujah, something, oh God, hallelujah. We're standing in this pandemic, oh God. We're standing in the midst of racism, oh God. We're standing in the midst of confusion, oh God. We're standing, oh God, but we stand, oh God, knowing that we can depend on you, oh God, that you never let us down, oh God. You said you'd never leave us or forsake us, oh God. So we praise you on this morning, oh God. Hallelujah, we love you, God. Hallelujah, we love you, God. We love you, God. Hallelujah. And even though things don't look like we want them to do, oh God, but we know that you have a plan for us, oh God. And the plan, oh God, is for us to step out in victory. So we thank you, God. We glorify you, God. God, I know I failed in saying hallelujah a lot, oh God, but we, Lord God, we lift up the children. Hallelujah, those that are in schools on this morning, oh God. Those teachers, the staff, the faculty, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you would cover them. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Lord God, again, I haven't said much, oh God, but I praise you, God, that you're an all-knowing God. Hallelujah. You know what we stand in the need of, oh God. You see all, oh God. Father God, and you meet us there, oh God, before we even get there. Hallelujah, and I bless your name on this morning for that. Lord God, this is my prayer. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen, amen. And amen.
And I have to know.
I have to know.
Yeah, yeah, say that. Say that.
I have to know.
God continues to bless us in ministry as we continue to expand ministry and as streaming has become the new norm. We welcome this morning to the team, our dear brother and friend and member, Brother Earl. Brother Earl, look right into that camera right there and say he's all masked up and all ministry up. Amen. And ready for the task at hand. We ask you to share with us now our announcements.
Good morning, Easton. Dominic G here. Just want to bring a couple of quick announcements to you. And first off, I want to welcome you to the first Sunday of autumn. As such, next Sunday will be the first Sunday of October, which means we'll be having communion online during the worship service. Now, we have two ways for you to participate with the communion. First off, you could come by the church today between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. to pick up a communion cup. This way you can partake in communion with us next Sunday. If for some reason you cannot make it today, you can also come next Sunday after the morning broadcast for the drive-through communion. That'd be also between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. Now just keep in mind, you do not have to be a member of East End to partake in communion with us. Everyone is welcome. Also, please join Dr. Stallworth this Wednesday via Zoom in the conference line between 6 p.m. and 7 p.m. as he continues his study on religion, racism, and patriotism in America. During this month of September, Dr. Stallworth has been celebrating his 40th year preaching anniversary. He's been preaching since he was 16 years old, so you can imagine what life's been like for him. But he's not shy about this. He has oftentimes shared his life experiences in his sermons to let us know that through the scrutiny of Christian living, living a godly life does not mean living a perfect life. Dr. Stallworth has accepted mentorship. He has pursued education. He has pursued studies and achieved various degrees and doctrines to bring a wholesome word of God. Dr. Stallworth has been preaching sermons from the East Coast all the way to the West Coast, and look at him now online looking to even break those barriers. Dr. Stallworth is not one to pretend to know it all, but he does find a way to encourage you through life's situations. He has been a friend, he has been a mentor to many, he has been a father figure in the ministry, and he also works beyond the walls of the church, being a leader and a spokesman for the community. So to you, Dr. Stallworth, I want to congratulate you. I want to thank you for being a human, for being a friend, and for being a man of God. But don't just take my word for it. Take a couple of minutes to listen to a few messages from some colleagues and some friends also congratulating you on this milestone and momentous achievement. God bless you.
Hello, my name is Tim Lett. This is my wife, Joanna. We are thrilled to take this opportunity to send congratulations and best wishes to our friend and brother, the Reverend Dr. Charlie Stallworth. It's amazing how God causes your paths to cross with people that you wouldn't have met otherwise, apart from divine intervention. And we are grateful to have become lifelong friends with our friend Charlie Stallworth. And we congratulate you, and we send our best wishes and our blessings and our prayers for all of God's best, and hopefully maybe even another 40 years of preaching. God bless you, friend. We love you.
Hi, I'm Minister Renata Harris, and I'd like to take this opportunity to honor our pastor, the Reverend Dr. C.L. Stallworth, and wish him a happy 40th preaching anniversary. Happy anniversary, Pastor. God bless you.
In 1980, I was 6 years old. Jimmy Carter was the president, and gas was 79 cents a gallon. There was a lot going on in 1980, but most importantly, somewhere down in the deep, dark woods of Alabama, a young man named Charlie Stallworth was preaching his initial sermon. 40 years of successful ministry. I want to say, Doc, congratulations. You've been steadfast and unmovable. You've persevered even through the storm. And that's remarkable and should be commended. This is a wonderful milestone. I want to thank you for being a friend. I want to thank you for embracing me as your best friend. I want to thank you for your mentorship. I want to thank you for the things you do in your community. Doc, you are an example to many young men coming behind you. And I believe you got 40 more years in you, Doc. If you go, I'll follow you. I'll support you. Man, you've been a great help to me in my ministry. And I want to thank you. Congratulations on 40 years, and keep going.
Thank you.
everybody. It's Sue Hatfield, and I just want to say huge congratulations to my friend, Dr. Charlie Stallworth, on 40 years of preaching ministry. Couldn't be prouder of you. Thank you very much for all that you do for your community, and it's a pleasure to know you. You bring the world closer together, and thank you. Here's to another 40 more. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.
Good morning. I'm Reverend Chauncey Hall, Executive Minister, Corinthian Baptist Church, and assistant to Pastor Whitfield. Wanted to just say a couple of things this morning. First, there are black people in Iowa. And then the second thing that I wanted to say is I noticed that Pastor Stallworth has a little more gray hair, and I'm probably responsible for half of them. Congratulations. Wish you the best on this 40th anniversary.
Congratulations, Pastor Stallworth, for the 40 years you have served in the ministry. Let me take this opportunity to join others in congratulating you. Wow, time certainly does fly when you're having fun and doing things that you love for the Lord. I want to thank the Lord for your gifts to the ministry and for allowing our paths to cross. No one knew God's plans with my life. But because of your wisdom, knowledge, revelation, your heart and love for ministry, your leadership has been instrumental in my development and growth in my pastoral role that I walk in. May your cup continually run over and blessings always be at your feet. Congratulations on your silver 40th ministry anniversary. Love you.
Good morning, good morning. I'm sitting here in my office thinking over the span of these last 23 years of preaching. I remember my mind begins to ponder back 20 years ago when I stepped onto the campus of Selma University. Knew nobody. No one took an interest in a little struggling preacher from Orlando, Florida. But one tall gentleman took a chance on me, and my life has never been the same. I thank God for him. I would not be where I am today or have pretty much anything that I have if it were not for the guidance, tutelage, mentorship, and father figure of Charlie Stallworth. Doc, I want to congratulate you for 40 years of preaching. I pray God's richest blessings upon you and the East End Church. Party like I'm there, and thank God for you. God bless you.
Amen. My heart is just filled with joy and with a spiritual ecstasy based on thank you, G, and thank you for all of my friends and all of those who have sent cards, you have sent text messages and emails. Indeed, I am grateful. God, who has kept me for 40 years, and believe me, it was nobody but the Lord. And so I am indeed delighted. I continue to thank you, East End, and those who share with us as you continue to support the church financially and be able to do what God has called us to do. Even in this new season, this new moment, you continue to be steadfast. And I remind us that there are several ways that we can continue to give, and you do not have to be a member to give. If you're scrolling by and this service is a blessing to you, you can give. Or if you're scrolling by and you hate the service, you can still give. It is just open to all who would like to share. Remember, there are several ways to give. You can use Giblify. Simply go to the Giblify app and locate East End Baptist Tabernacle Church, 548 Central Avenue, Bridgeport, Connecticut, 06607. And you can give using Giblify. You can also give using Cash App. Cash tag EEBTC, Cash App. You can also give using that form. Also, you can use the postal service, 548, make an address to East End Baptist Tabernacle Church, 548 Central Avenue, Bridgeport, Connecticut, 06607, and it will get to the proper place. Just drop it in the mail. Also, as Brother G has said, many will be here immediately after the service, and our trustees will be here as well. If you need to drop your offering off, as the trustees will be here to receive it. As a matter of fact, those who use your electronic instrument, your phone or your iPad, whatever, to give, I'm going to go ahead and ask you to take this moment to to give your gift to God. Oh, yes. How great. Oh, yeah. Sing up to heaven. Oh, we bless your name,
sing
God.
With me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see
how great
is our God.
Come on, say that again. Say that again. How great is our God. Oh, yeah. This morning we make ready for our sermonic selection. We know often when we were in a season in which we would go to visit other churches, we would call them our sister churches. But also in the virtual world, we have sister churches as we worship with the First Institutional Church in Phoenix a couple of weeks ago. Another one of our sister churches through this virtual world is the Shiloh Church in New London, Connecticut. And we want to share in deep sympathy and prayer with Bishop Watts and that church family upon the passing of Lamont who did their music ministry. And as many of us watched him on Tuesday as he ministered and then went home to be with the Lord. And so we continue to lift up that family, that church family, and understand how difficult it must be for them today. But know your friends at East End are praying for you and holding you high in the faith. Yes, you would. Just join me with the word of prayer for them. God, we thank you. We love you. And so we pray for our brothers and sisters, Brother Lamont's church and his family, his children, all of his family members, that you would keep them in your care. And in this hour of Sunday morning, that you would minister to them like only you can do. Because we understand to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, but we also know the challenge that involves. So we ask you to empower them and to strengthen them. And we shall forever give you the glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Our preaching theme for 2020 is to give God a yes. And giving God that yes, we ask God to overflow in this place. To have your way in this place.
Overflow
in this place.
In this place.
Oh my God.
Have your way
in this place.
We want more.
In this place.
In this place.
Have your way.
Have
your way.
Overflow.
In this place.
In this place.
Have your way.
Have your way.
In this place.
In this place.
We want more.
We want more.
In this place. Have your way.
Have your way.
We can't, we can't, we can't, we can't.
We can't walk
without you.
Without you.
Oh my God, we can't.
We can't talk
without you.
Without you.
We can't.
We can't live
without you.
Without you.
Have your way.
Have your way.
God, that is still our proclamation. We can't walk. Without you.
Without you.
Oh my God. We can't
talk.
Without you.
Without you.
Oh my God. We can't
live.
Without you.
Without you.
Have your way.
Have your way.
I know I got some stuff in me that you got to take out of me. So if it's not pleasing.
If it's not pleasing to you,
take it out of me.
Take it out of me.
Oh my God. If it's
not pleasing to you,
take it out of me.
Take it out of me.
Got to tell God that.
If it's not pleasing to you,
take it out of me.
Take it out of me.
Have your way.
Have your way.
Then when you don't know what else to say, Big Mama would moan. Oh, she would moan up. Yes, you would. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Oh, yeah. Moan it, moan it, moan it, moan it. Thank you, God. 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 Overflow. In this place, have your way.
Have your way.
In this place, God, we want more. Bless his name. Oh, hit that note. I like that. bless the name of our God. We return this week back to the text that we looked at last week. And as we will preach a continuation of it today, Exodus chapter 14, verses 21 through 25, and Exodus 15, verses 1 through 3, as rendered by the New International Version of the Holy Scriptures. Exodus 14, verses 21 through 25, and Exodus 15, verses 1 through 3. Exodus 14, 21 through 25 reads, "Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind, and it turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with the wall of water on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued them, and all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of fire and cloud at the Egyptian army and threw it into confusion. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so that they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, 'Let's get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt.'" And then Exodus 15, verses 1 through 3. "Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord, 'I will sing to the Lord, for he's highly exalted. Both horse and driver he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He's my God and I will praise him. My father's God and I would exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name.'" God, we thank you and we pray now that you would breathe on us as we share with your people your word. Give us the kind of anointing that makes preaching a joy. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. We want to tag this text, as we did last week, with this title, "Life Beyond the Initial Promise." The C-S-E-A. Life Beyond the Initial Promise. The C. The C, the C, the C, the C. The object or objects we face en route to our initial promise that cannot be ignored, denied, bypassed, or wished away. That's what the C is. The object, I'm getting some feedback from somebody's equipment here. Thank you. The C, the object or objects we face en route to our initial promise that cannot be ignored, denied, bypassed, or wished away. The object that must be faced. There are five components to this C that we started last week. The first we listed last week, water. Water is the majority content of the C. And this water represents moving ahead regardless to the fears pressing in on us. The water is representative of acting before the way is made. It is taking a step before you know where you're going to put your foot. Before the sea was separated, God told the children of Israel to move forward. Whether you can swim or not, move forward. That's what the sea, in the sea, the first encounter that we face is water. And I say to you, whatever you fear this morning, move forward in spite of what your fear is. Well, there are four more elements to the sea that I want to discuss in our sermonic presentation today. And here they are. And I will repeat the first one just so you will have them in some sort of sequence or order. One, water. Two, wind. Three, walls. Four, wheels. And five, worship. I think I'll back up, put it in neutral, calm it down, slap it in reverse, and back up for a moment. That as we're going forward in that initial promise that God has given us, and we've reached that first obstacle called the sea, in that sea encounter, we will experience at least four moments: water, wind, walls, wheels, and worship. And since we've already looked at water, we can go on now and deal with the next. But I want to say to you that these stages are like the stages of grief. They can occur at any time, in sequence, out of sequence, or repeated sequence. In other words, you can be at water today, wheels tomorrow, back at water on Monday, wheels on or walls on Wednesday, wind by Friday, worship on Saturday, and then back to water again. They can come in any order. They can even repeat themselves. But we looked at the water. Now, join me as we look at the wind. Look at the text. We're informed from Exodus 14, 21, and it says, then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. And all that night, the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind. And it turned into dry land. The waters were divided. Did you get that? All that night, the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind. The wind. Walk with me. Because I'm amazed at this text because it continues with the element of time. The Lord used not some of the night, but all the night to drive the wind back. You see, we often miss out on this continuing element of time. Check this out. When you got time to spare, you don't mind things taking time. Let me see if I can make it live. If you are not in a hurry and somebody in front of you is driving slow, you may or may not go around. But if you are running late for work for the last time, because you have already been involved, show up late one more time, and it ain't going to be nothing to show up to. And then a person is driving in front of you and is slow. You start saying things about their ancestors that you don't even know and talking about their mama. When you got time on your side, you don't mind taking some time. But when you don't seem to have time on your side, you want things to move right now, and that's including God. As I heard some single person increasing in age say, when it comes to relationship, I don't have time for another lesson. Many years earlier in my life, I worked as an emergency medical technician. I never met anyone on a call who thought we arrived fast. Most people, though, it had only been a few minutes between the call being placed in the ambulance with us showing up, would often ask us, why did it take so long? Why? The reason is because when you sense that you need something right now, seconds feel like minutes. Minutes feel like hours. Hours feel like days. Days feel like months. And you know what months feel like forever. The wind stage of this existence, though it could be a short time, feels like a long time. Because the text says, all that night. And anyone in this stage right now, in anyone who's like the biblical writer who's asking God, how long? Anyone teetering on that rhetorical question, how long tonight? How long would I be in this season? That's the feeling you get when you are in this stage beyond the initial promise when the wind is blowing. But there's more to this wind. Walk with me. Because this is a strange text with a helpful truth. According to the text, now, get this, there is light on the children of Israel, but darkness over the Egyptian army and darkness over the sea. Walk with me. Three sections. Darkness over the Egyptians, light over the children of Israel, and darkness over the sea. God is using the wind to drive back the sea, but the children of Israel can't see it. Preach, Starwood, I think I will, since I'm standing up with the mic in my hand. God is using the wind to drive back the sea, but the children of Israel can't see it.
they have a hint that something might be going on, because no doubt they can hear the wind, but there's no evidence of what God is doing. That's the wind season. You sense God is working, but you ain't for sure. You testify he's working it out, but deep down you wonder if he's really doing anything. That's the wind season. You see, the only option left, since you don't know what God is doing, the only option left in this wind season is that, since you can't figure out what God is doing, is to work on yourself. Whoo! The wind, a time of uncertainty and personal development. It's a time of uncertainty because though it feels like God is working, you don't know for sure if God is working. But it is a time for personal development, that there are some things that we can work on that will work on ourselves. What is it that you need to work on to be able to get to the next step? Because often we often pray as if we are ready to receive what we are asking God for. But since we don't know how long the wind season might last, we have to start working on ourselves now. What is it that you need to work on right now? What personal development do you need to take a jab at? Is it something spiritual, like joy or peace or forbearance or kindness or goodness or faithfulness, gentleness, self-control? Are you asking God to give you more, but yet you have not developed that you don't cuss out the few you got now? What is it that you can work on right now? Is it something like taking care of yourself physically, maybe getting some exercise or listening to your doctor? Is it something financial, like stop purchasing stuff to impress others? The wind, on the one hand, is that sense in which you can sense God is working but can't confirm it. But on the other hand, is a time when you can start and continue working on your own personal development. Children of Israel, take this time to stop blaming God. Take this time to stop blaming Moses. Take this time to get out of your mind what happened back in Egypt. Take this time to get the graves off your mind. Get yourself together just in case God is working. When God is ready for the next step, you will be ready for the next step. The sea, water, going forward in spite of your fears. The wind. Personal development, when you sense God might be working. But then next, the walls. W-A-L-L-S. The waters that are parted because the sea blows them back all night forms into two walls. That's a mighty good picture, G. It shows it better than I preach it. The sea, note G's picture, does not rise equally on the right and the left. It is not like the whole sea just simply stood up and rose equally on each side. Rather, the water displaced by the winds form walls, watery walls, walls made of water. I remember when I was in Taiwan visiting, and they had this long bridge with a whole lot of water. And they asked me if I wanted to walk. And I told them, heaven to the no. Eyes good right here. But the water forms walls. Watery walls, walls made of water. No reinforcement or foundation built deeply into the sea, but simply walls of water. Water on water, water in water. Normally, walls are intended to separate one thing from another, inside from outside, your space from somebody else's space. But here, the wall is the same as that which the children of Israel would be separated from. Listen, Exodus 14, 21 through 22. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night, The Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall of water on their right and on their left. The children of Israel not only had to proceed toward the sea before the waters parted, but they also had to walk through walls of water after the sea parted. If you think you're scared going through a sea where there's still water, think about going through one where there are walls. You see, in walking toward the water, they had to face their fears. But in walking through the walls of water, they had to demonstrate their trust in God who made the walls. Listen, it is one thing to overcome your fear, but overcoming fear is not all. We must also enact our trust. You see, walls are representative of those moments when we must trust God. Now, I know, I feel you. Trust seems simple and easy to do until you find yourself in the moment in which trust is necessary. The story is told of a man walking along the edge of a cliff. He slips over the edge of the cliff, and all he has to hold on to is a branch protrudes from the side of the cliff. In desperation, he calls out, "Is there anyone up there? Help me, please." He hears a voice that says, "Let go. I will catch you." The man repeats this plea several more times, and each time he hears the same response back, "Let go. I'm God. I will catch you." Yet instead of the man letting go, the man cries out again, "Hey, is there anyone else up there?" Trust is easy until you have to do it. The children of Israel had to trust that the God who made the walls can also hold the walls in place as we walk through. Here it is. The God who got you there can keep you while you are there. Look here. First, Moses stretches forth his hand over the sea. That's human participation. Second, God causes a strong wind to drive the sea back. That's God's participation. But three, the bed of the sea turns to dry ground. That's nature's participation. The Israelites go through on dry ground. That's the children of Israel's participation. Now, all of these are noticeable entities on each side, but here's the power. In each case, someone other than the children of Israel acted, but the deal is not sealed until the children of Israel demonstrate their trust by walking through the walls. As we look at the children of Israel, we can ask some questions to which we don't have answers, such as, how high were the walls? How sturdy were the walls? Did the walls have any water bulges? We don't know. All we know is that the children of Israel had the trust necessary to walk through the walls. If we're going to promise God, if we're going to the promise God has for us, we have to trust God. We must trust God, because there will be some places where you will walk through the walls, and the walls will be on either side of you, and you will not be focusing on the fact that God departed the waters, but you'll be focusing on the fact of the walls going to fall. You see, trust in this text is being able to see one action of God and proceeding with the next action of God because you saw the first action. Let me see if I can make it live. You don't know what God would do next week, but you're going to trust because you know what God did last week. You don't know how the finances will work out this month, but you are going to trust God because you know how God worked it out last month. The walls represents those moments, those times when we know God is working and we simply have to walk through while facing great concerns. And when we get doubtful, we have to tell ourselves that the ground is still dry, so the walls must still be up. But wait, there's more. Walls are not only for times of trust, and walls are for times of protection. Look at the text. The enemies, Pharaoh's army, saw the walls and said, "Let's proceed." But how many of you know the walls that are for you are not for everyone? I don't want to pre-preach myself, but let it suffice to say the same walls that saved the children of Israel were the same walls that collapsed on the Egyptians. You better tell somebody, this for me. You don't want any of this. This is for me. These walls are for me. You may snatch them. You may steal them. But believe me, you'll bring them back, because these walls are for me. It's like a prescription. The medicine might be good, but it ain't for everybody. But let me move on to visiting the portion that really deals with the enemies. We have looked at the water. We have looked at the wind. We have looked at the walls. But let's proceed to the next part, the wheels. Yeah, wheels. Wheels are for mobility. Wheels on bikes and cycles and cars and trucks and skates are for mobility, movement to get you from one place to another place. In a time past and gone, people were not just excited about the color, the model, and the speed of an automobile. They wanted to know about the wheels. What kind of wheels do you have on that automobile? But there are wheels with interpretive value in this text. Verses 23 through 25 says, the Egyptians pursued them, and all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of fire and cloud at the Egyptian army and threw it into confusion. He jammed the wheels. I didn't put that there. It was already there. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so that they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, let's get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt. Get this. The Lord did not follow up against the enemy with another strike of the next born. The Lord did not send another plague, not another drop of blood, not another frog, not another lice, not another livestock pestilence, and not another boil, not another drop of hail, and not another locust. God attacked at a place where the child of God nor the enemy expected. Get this. Maybe we should stop suggesting to God how to deal with our enemies. You see, we want God to slow them down, but we don't know that simply means they're at a slower pace, but they're still chasing us. Maybe we want God to knock them out, but little do we know, devils don't die. They simply wake up at some point. Maybe we should just leave that decision to God, because God knows how to jam their wheels. Can somebody say that in virtual land? When it comes to the enemy, God knows how to jam the wheels. Wheels were jammed is symbolic of God's protection. That God is protecting you, not fighting your enemy the way you think God ought to be fighting your enemy. But God is fighting your enemy in a way that you nor your enemy expects. God knows how to jam the wheels. I know many of us have concerns this week, the lack of justice in the Breonna Taylor case, where a police officer is charged for the bullets that missed. And not the ones that took this beautiful sister's life. We've been bothered by a president, the political parties rushed to name and confirm a Supreme Court justice. We've been further bothered by the fact of knowing the issues before the Supreme Court and what this could mean. Many of us believe that they will succeed, and maybe they will, but we can never forget that in the final analysis, that God still knows how to jam wheels. And because you get through does not mean you get away. The enemy got into the sea, but did not get away. How are you still here? When you know someone wanted to take you out, God jammed the wheels. How is it that you got the job when everybody else was working against you? God jammed the wheels. You get this, by jamming their wheels, their forward progress and their backward progress were both stopped and their movement destroyed along with them, because now they can't retrace the steps they took to get to the children of Israel. Come here. I haven't said that in a while. Now, closer. Come here. Calm down. Yeah. Stop worrying. You don't have to respond to every assault. You don't have to jump up at every attack. You don't have to say something ugly or go because you want to tell the person a piece of your mind to everyone who says something mean to you. Get this. God still knows how to jam wheels. And as you march toward your promise, you would encounter your sea, the thing that you cannot ignore, deny, or wish away. And in that sea, you will face water. You will face wind. You will face walls. You will face wheels. But there's one more, and I'm going to take my seat. That is worship. Once the children of Israel make it through the sea, the water, the wind, the walls, the wheels, they worship. Wait. They are not yet in the promised land. They still got some more hurdles to cross. Yet when we see them on the other side of the sea, they are worshiping. Maybe you haven't gotten to the promise yet. And maybe you are frustrated because you haven't gotten to the promise. Let me remind you that there will be a great vacuum that needs to be filled with worship right at this moment, at the sea, in the initial promise, before you get to the fulfillment. You know, I ought to dance myself right here. After every sea you cross on your way to the promised land, you ought to stop and worship. After every drop of water you go through, you should stop and worship. After every wall you journey through, you should stop and worship. After every wheel comes off the enemy's attack, you ought to stop and worship. Your worship does not mean the entire fight is over or the promise has been fulfilled, but your worship means that you have overcome another victory. Here it is, worship. You worship because it is not the completion of the promise, but rather it is a victory experienced on your way to the promise. If you're going to wait till the whole party before it's over, before you get your dance in, you ought not even show up. You got to be willing to tell God, thank you for every victory, though the battle is still not over. Yeah. Has anyone experienced any victories on the way? You need to pause and worship. He brought me. Stop and worship. He kept me. Stop and worship. He's holding me. Stop and worship. Let me add this and I'm done, really. I heard Dr. Howard John Wesley, pastor of the Afford Street Baptist Church, Washington, D.C., discuss in a recent sermon that the highest crime in academic honor is plagiarism. That is to take something that's not original to you and claim authorship of it. Be like for me to stand up and say, I was walking the other day and the Lord gave me a song and I wrote it and here it is, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. Yeah, that would be plagiarism. But it will also be plagiarism for me to stand in this pulpit and claim that everything that has happened in my life for good is because of my own doing. It was God who kept me. It was God who brought me. And it was God who grounded me. Can anybody say that? It was God who kept me. It was God who brought me. It was God who grounded me. And I'm not where I want to go. I'm not at the end of the journey. But bless God, I'm going to stop and worship right here. Yes, come on, core group. Listen to the children of Israel in our text. Verses 1 through 3. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord. For he's highly exalted. All right. Both horse and driver he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My Father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. But let me read a little more in verses 4 through 6. Pharaoh's chariots, they still worshiping. And his army he has hurled into the sea. The best of Pharaoh's officers are drowned in the Red Sea. The deep waters have covered them. They sank to the depths like a stone. Your right hand, Lord, how what was majestic in power. Your right hand, Lord, shadowed the enemy. I think I will share with them and worship God right where I am. There ought to be somebody somewhere who knows that God has spoken a promise in your life and you have faced that sea of water, wind, walls, wheels, but you got to worship. And I just want to tell you, if you don't know what you ought to say, you ought to just say praise him because he brought you. Praise him because he taught you. Praise him.
Yes.
Because he kept you. Praise him. Because he never went away. Praise him. Because he never gave up on you. Praise him. Because he was there when all the others walked out. Praise him. Because while you were a sinner, he still died for you. Praise him. Because when you pray, he hears you. But praise him. Because even when you don't pray, he still hears you. Praise him. Oh, bless his holy name. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. As you hear your initial promise and you discover it's not happening right now, you discover yourself at the sea, that thing that you cannot not ignore, deny, or wish away. When you're at that sea and you face your water, you face those walls, face that wind. You had that moment when God's working on the wheels. Don't forget to worship him. Praise him. Praise him. Blessed Savior. He's worthy to. Come on, right where you are, lift up your voices. Come on. Come on, come on, come on.
Praise him.
Come on, come on, come on.
Praise him.
Praise him, praise him.
Praise him.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Bless it.
Bless it, Savior.
Oh my God, you're worthy.
You're worthy to
be. Come on, say that again. Praise him, praise him.
Lord. Praise him, Lord. Praise him.
Jesus.
Oh God. You know, it is in this season that it does not matter who you are, how upbeat, how Holy Ghost filled, that all of us have some of those moments when life wants to get the very best of us. But I challenge you that even in that moment, even if there's sadness on your face with a tear in your eye, this is the time to work your way through. And one way to work your way through is to say, God, I know what you promised me. And though I don't know what you're doing in the background right now, I do remember the victories I've had. And because of those victories, I'm going to keep on worshiping you. I'm going to keep on serving you. And even though I don't see it, I'm going to keep on praising you. So every time I get, every moment I want to drop my head, every time I want to give up, every time I want to cry, I'm going to throw my hands up and say, praise. That's what I want to do. That's how I want to worship y'all. That's what I want to hold on to. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Jesus.
One more time and we are done. Oh, from the